the most brutal and undeserving execution of all time.
This man's done nothing wrong.
In reality, it was even worse.
It's a form of torture more than it is an instrument of death.
The conspiracy behind the crucifixion.
I think that the story needs to be known.
On today's 700 Club Interactive.
On 700 Club Interactive, we use technology to pray for each other and explore topics that matter to you. Watch what God is doing in the world today.
Welcome to 700 Club Interactive. It's a crime that was born in secret meetings involving the top political and religious leaders of the day.
It's become the most fiercely debated murder of all time, and at the center of it, a conspiracy like nothing the world had ever seen.
Beaten, tortured, and crucified.
This was worse than someone going to the electric chair in the ancient world.
2,000 years ago, a nomadic preacher was nailed to a cross. Executed as a common criminal, he was the victim of the greatest conspiracy of all time.
Now, with Stephen Mansfield, his book, Killing Jesus, is an in-depth account of what led to the crucifixion of Jesus Christ. It's great to have you with
us.
Thank you for being here. You start out the book by talking about the death of Herod, which was pretty gruesome.
It was.
And he really took his last breath thinking that he had taken care of his great rival. Talk about that.
King Herod was a very vain man. He was always trying to preserve his legacy. He was dying horribly, worm-eaten and fevered. And he had heard from these men who had come from the east, we know them as the wise men, that there was a prophesied king. And of course, we know that he sent soldiers to kill the children in Bethlehem. And he was comforted by this. I've killed all rivals. My family will survive. Turns out, of course, he was wrong. Jesus was in Egypt with his family. And but maybe more importantly, you know, his family died out within 100 years. So it's the curse of those who try to preserve their legacy in some unrighteous, ungodly way.
You address so many things in your book, but one of the things you talk about is the Nazi lie, so to speak, that it was the Jews who killed Christ. In fact, most Jews appreciated Jesus and even followed after him. It was a small, powerful group of people who really were involved in this conspiracy.
And you know, this is so obvious from scripture. It's funny that it's tragic that this lie has survived in history. The Sanhedrin tried Jesus overnight. Why? Because the people found Jesus, they loved him. He was very popular with them, and they didn't want to have a riot. When they took Jesus through the streets the next day, they wept openly, you know. The reality is that Jesus' death was sort of instigated by a small cabal, a family, and some corrupt leaders, not all the Jews by any stretch. And so this is who Jesus was gunning for, so to speak, that small conspiratorial group in charge of the temple at the time. And I think it's important to realize, too, that the one statement that's been most used by people who are anti-Semitic, let his blood be upon us, that the people gathered in that court area in front of the Praetorium, this was a small group of people that, again, those corrupt leaders had brought together to chant and to kind of give the appearance to Pilate as though this was the voice of the people, and it wasn't. So it's a tragic lie, and it's cost millions of lives and lots of suffering as a result.
One of the statements that Jesus made was that he was going to destroy the temple. And even though this was a corrupt small group of people in leadership at the time, the temple represented the system of everything that existed.
Yes.
Was that the real catalyst for this ire?
Yes. Again, you know, it has been sort of the heritage of theological liberalism to look at everything in the Bible in political terms. But you have to apply some political terms here. The temple was where the taxes were collected, even for Rome, not just the tribute amongst the Jews. Every day, a sacrifice was made for the Roman emperor. The temple was everything, the biggest institution. It's where all the money flowed in. Everything was there. And so when Jesus seemed to threaten the temple, tear this temple down, of course, speaking of his body, not the actual, or when anything was said that might rock the Roman support for that little corrupt group of client kings, so to speak, that's the kind of thing that would turn those leaders against him violently. And so there's a political balance of power happening, and Jesus threatened it. And that's a lot of the human reason he was killed.
How real was the threat of rebellion against Rome?
Well, not very likely. Just simply, I mean, there were always little riots and there were always uprisings amongst the Jews, especially during Passover when 125,000 people, historians tell us, would have been in Jerusalem. It was a volatile time. But that's also when the Romans reinforced their garrison there and had thousands of troops. So I don't think there was much chance of some sort of total rebellion, just uprisings and voicing of anger. But I think that it was a fear the Romans constantly had. And we hear Caiaphas say, look, if this happens, we're going to lose our nation.
Yeah.
And that was always the concern, that the Romans would come swooping in and take away the authority that these corrupt little pro-Roman leaders had.
I'm always provoked in thought when I read Pontius Pilate's reaction to Jesus, because it was so evident that he really didn't want to convict this man or send him to his death. But that little conversation that they had really took a turn. Talk about that.
It's interesting, isn't it? Pontius Pilate doesn't seem to be a man of any religious views. And we don't know that he was an especially honest man. I mean, he killed people unrighteously. But at that moment, he looks at Jesus and says, this man's done nothing wrong. Why am I being forced to put him to death? He's squeezed, frankly, between the will of the Jews and Tiberius Caesar, who had said, be nice to the Jews. Let's remove these tensions that have been there for decades. And yet we almost get hopeful for a moment. No, it's almost as though he's seeing something that he hadn't seen before and maybe even likes Jesus a little bit. Yeah. So it's one of those tragic near moments in the Bible, and I don't know that there is any explanation for it these centuries later.
And yet despite that, the death sentence that was given was extreme.
It was horribly extreme. It was probably carried out in a more extreme way than even the sentence itself. He was scourged, which often was punishment enough.
Yeah.
They would simply stop with that. Then he was beaten and he was crucified, which is a form of torture more than it is an instrument of death. Men lived for days in agony. It wasn't meant to kill a man immediately. It was meant to torture him. So this was an extreme sentence overall. And we have to remember, of course, that this is theologically, it's a result of God pouring out his wrath upon Jesus that we deserve. This ought to make us weep. So it was horrible, far more horrible than is usually described. And I think for those reasons, those spiritual reasons.
Romans had a way of really getting the max out of this kind of a sentence to someone. And when you describe that, it is gruesome. It's gory to think about. And yet, out of that comes our salvation.
You know, I think we Christians, we want to honor Jesus in all the ways we're commanded to in Scripture. Certainly one of the ways is looking right into the face of what happened to Jesus. Mm-hmm. We shouldn't shy away. Even some Christians criticized Mel Gibson for attempting to put its graphic nature on film. Well, don't we honor him by knowing what he endured?
Yes.
For example, that the cross was not just a way of killing Jesus. They could have just done it another way, and you can imagine what those would have been. It was a form of torture, of agonizing torture, hour and after hour, as a man gasps for breath and scrapes his raw back up and down on raw wood. To know that deepens my love for him. And every single drop of blood, every single moment of agony was redemptive for us. So I don't want to major on it. I don't want to shove it in people's faces necessarily, but I do want Christians at least to understand it.
Well, you say that you have been, this book's been percolating in your mind for some time, but the time wasn't right to write it. Why today? Why now?
I think we live in a more crass, violent age. I don't think violence surprises us that much. This couldn't have been written in, let's say, the 50s or the 60s.
Yeah.
I'm not sure it could have been written at times when maybe we were more politically correct about violence. Mm. Maybe it had to be written some years after Mel Gibson's film. I don't know. And maybe I can do things on the page that you can't do in film because it would have to be X-rated for violence, I guess. So it needed to percolate in me. I needed to read, travel, consult scholars over the years. Then at just the right time, the right publisher. But I think that the story needs to be known and needs to be a follow-up to all that people would know in our last decades.
Well, it's very thought-provoking, very informative.
Thank you
so much. I want to mention that the book is called Killing Jesus, The Unknown Conspiracy Behind the World's Most Famous Execution. This is available nationwide. Wonderful work. Thanks.
Great to be with you. Thank you.
Gordon?
Well, after the crucifixion, the body of Jesus was placed in a tomb. Guards rolled a stone over the entrance, and they watched the tomb for 3 days. We'll show you what happened next when we come back.
In 2008, my husband Gary departed for heaven. I was still grieving. And then to find out I had cancer, I began praying, God, how do I do this? Where do I do this? Cancer Treatment Centers of America was the place. Dr. Neelam outlined a plan that would take care of my mind and my body, and she prayed with me.
For Bible-believing Christians, we're able to pray with them in a much deeper way as they begin to really rely upon their faith.
At Cancer Treatment Centers of America, we believe in the power of faith and prayer as indispensable allies in the fight against complex and advanced stage cancer.
I'm back in Telluride on the mountain skiing. I feel strong and healthy.
Advanced medicine and technology.
And I am a survivor.
The warm embrace of the spirit and the power of prayer.
These are happy tears.
Please go to cancercenter.com/faith. Appointments available now. Cancer Treatment Centers of America, care that never quits.
CBN TV on CBN.com. All the video you love in one easy-to-use location.
What is wrong with you?
I hate you.
Easier than that. You just don't know what to do.
Being a foster or adoptive parent can be very difficult. I know. I've been there. That's why Orphans Promise developed Adoption and Foster RX, Solutions for Wounded Families. In this DVD series, parenting experts take on the tough issues and offer proven strategies. Don't miss this vital information. Call now, because there is hope for wounded families.
When you start going, the windows blew.
Caught in a tornado.
The whole house blew.
A child is taken from his bedroom.
My 8-year-old's gone.
And floats back home.
It's a miracle that all of our lives were spared.
Next week on 700 Club Interactive. On Easter Sunday, a woman named Mary Magdalene went to a tomb. She wanted to check on the body of Jesus and instead became the first witness to the greatest event in history. Here's how it was depicted in a recent episode of Superbook.
John! I've seen him! He is alive!
Alive?
What are you talking about?
How can that be? Stay here.
Exactly what did you see?
I couldn't sleep. I went to the tomb.
Woman, why are you weeping?
They have taken the Lord's body out of the tomb, and we don't know where they have put him.
Why are you crying? Who are you looking for?
If you have taken him away, tell me where you have put him, and I will go and get him.
Yet ascended to my Father, but go find my brothers and tell them, I am ascending to my Father and your Father, and to my God and your God.
Well, that's just a sample from the Superbook series. We want to get the stories of the Bible to the children of the world, and you can be a part of it by joining the Superbook DVD Club. Now, what does that mean? It means for your donation of $25, which goes to the production, translation, distribution costs around the world, and our goal is for 300 million children to see this series over the next 5 years. We've got it scheduled for translation into languages like Hindi and Telugu and Urdu and Bahasa Indonesian, Spanish, French. We want to cover Arabic speakers with it. We want to get the gospel out, the stories of the Bible out to the children of the world, and you can be a part of it for a donation of $25. Now, for that, we'll send you 3 copies of the latest episode, all part of the Superbook DVD Club. Right now, we've got the episode of Jonah, and you'll be first in line as new episodes are produced. If you want to see the episode He Is Risen, the one we just showed you a sample of, all you have to do is go to CBN.com and you can order back episodes there. Do it now. Call us, 888-777-1999. Just say, I want to join the Superbook DVD Club. Terry?
Well, up next, the prayer that kept death at bay. Hear why. Plus, we'll be praying for you and your needs. So don't go away. We'll be right back.
If you're the mother of a child with behavior problems, I'd like to talk to you. My name is Janet Lehman, and I'm a behavioral therapist and a mom. I know what it's like when the child that you love becomes a defiant, out-of-control child who disrespects you.
That's why my husband James and I created the Total Transformation, the program that tens of thousands of moms are now using to turn around their child's behavior.
If you've heard about the Total Transformation and wondered if it will work for you, now you can try it for free. I'm willing to give away 1,000 programs today for free.
All you need to do is get the program and let us know how it works for you. We'll let you keep it for free.
I know the Total Transformation works because I used these techniques with my own son and with troubled kids for over 30 years. Let me prove to you that it works by giving you the program free.
Call the number on your screen now to get the Total Transformation free.
In 2008, my husband Gary departed for heaven. I was still grieving. And then to find out I had cancer, I began praying, God, how do I do this? Where do I do this? Cancer Treatment Centers of America was the place. Dr. Neelam outlined a plan that would take care of my mind and my body, and she prayed with me.
Four Bible-believing Christians were able to pray with them in a much deeper way as they began to really rely upon their faith.
At Cancer Treatment Centers of America, we believe in the power of faith and prayer as indispensable allies in the fight against complex and advanced stage cancer.
I'm back in Telluride on the mountain skiing. I feel strong and healthy.
Advanced medicine and technology.
And I am a survivor.
The warm embrace of the spirit and the power of prayer.
These are happy tears.
Please go to cancercenter.com/faith. Appointments available now. Cancer Treatment Centers of America. Care that never quits.
I know that the Lord Jesus Christ heard my mama's prayers.
God answers our fervent, heartfelt prayers. God answers those, and He delivers us.
I realized that the stuff that I've been through, the 7 years I was on the streets, that God was going to use it for His glory.
And I felt so filled and so loved. I can live. I have something worth living for. Jesus loves me.
Watch The 700 Club next.
Trevor Gordon went through 2 pregnancies without any complications. In fact, she says she's never been sick a day in her life. So when doctors noticed something awry during a routine checkup, Trevor was concerned and couldn't imagine what was going to happen next.
I was fighting for my life, and I was afraid. How could I go from feeling wonderful to all of a sudden, hold on, fight for your life? Be strong.
Treva Gordon was pregnant with her 3rd child, a girl. But all her hopes and dreams for her unborn daughter turned to fear 37 weeks into her pregnancy.
That evening, we were watching television, having a wonderful time, and all of a sudden, I experienced a pain in my stomach like never before. It was like someone had taken a knife and had stabbed me in my stomach. And it immediately caused me to drop to my knees in pain. My son, he ran across the street to get the neighbor, and the neighbor came. She found me on the floor. I'd never felt pain like that before.
Treva was rushed to a local hospital where doctors diagnosed severe toxemia and several other life-threatening conditions.
Her blood pressures were stroke level. It was very close to death. Her liver hematoma was extremely large. It could have ruptured at any time. When they do rupture, the mortality for that event is extremely high.
Treva's husband, Robert, was recalled from military service in Iraq to be with her.
I was on a plane leaving within hours. When you hear something like that, first thing you want to do, you want to pray.
Treva's liver and kidneys were shutting down. Doctors performed an emergency C-section and saved Treva's baby. But Treva's life hung in the balance. After 2 days in intensive care, with no signs of improvement, she was life-flighted to Vanderbilt Hospital in Nashville.
It seemed as if there was a lot of chaos in the room, trying to get my kidney functions revived and working, and my liver functions had completely failed, and all I could do was just lie there and pray. I said, God, help me. I don't know what's going on with me. I've never been sick a day in my life. How did I go from feeling wonderful to this?
Treva was placed on a dialysis machine and spent several more days in the hospital, in and out of consciousness. Friends, family, and church members gathered in prayer for her survival. Treva says she had visions that death was waiting across the hall.
Prayer is what prevented death from coming over to take me. And he could not cross because of this white light. He said, as soon as this beam or this traffic of light stops, I'm going to come across this room and I'm going to take you. And I was so fearful, and I just kept saying, I don't want to die. I don't want to die.
When I walked in, it was a very desperate situation. The doctors had basically given up on her. That's when I realized that, you know, this was a make it or break it moment for her. And when I approached her bed, I just felt like the Lord told me, just go ahead and lay hands on her. You do what you're called to do and let me do what I'm here to do.
When I actually woke up and I could really see my pastor was standing there in the ER room, I was so glad to see him. And he was praying over me. And I just felt the peace of God, that God didn't forget about me. And I was still fighting for my life, but I thank God for the prayers.
Treva slowly began to heal. Her doctors told her she was fortunate to be alive, considering the severity of her condition when she arrived.
They said, many women come to this hospital in the condition you're in, and within 5 minutes of being in that condition, 5 minutes, they die right there on the table. And for you to have survived that, it's a miracle. I thank God for just being my doctor in a sick room at that hospital. I don't know why he allowed me to live, but he did. Amen.
After 2 weeks in the hospital, Treva was sent home for months of bed rest and kidney dialysis.
I knew that I had to fight. I knew others were praying for me, but I had to pray. I began to read the Word of God and to stand on His promises. I read every scripture about healing, and I took that in. He says, by His stripes, I am healed. I surrounded myself with the Word of God. I became strong. God says, let the weak say that I am strong. I began to say, greater is He who is in me than he who is in the world. And I felt the strength of God come.
Today, Treva is healed and healthy. She says it was God who brought her through. Her daughter Robin is a perfectly healthy little girl.
God has restored my organs. My kidneys are restored, my liver functions. No more high blood pressure, hypertension, none of that. I am healed today. I am a miracle.
Whatever the situation is, trust in God and believe God for it. Believe God for it. And it may not happen on that day when you want it to happen, but continue to believe God for it and just trust in God, and God will put you through it.
Treva is very strong in her faith, and I think that played a significant role in her healing. She had a lot to live for.
I'll never be ashamed to tell what God has done for me, because He has set me free. I should have been 6 feet under, but now I'm taking the gospel of Jesus Christ, and I'll tell it wherever I can tell it. That God is good.
God is good. Tell it, shout it from the housetops, from the mountaintops. Let people know God is good. You can rely on Him. That's what faith really is. It's trusting Him. It's relying on Him. That He who is promised is able. Now, who does God come through for? Well, the Bible's real specific. Who has believed our report? For whom is the arm of the Lord shown to be strong? When you link those two together, you understand it's faith that releases the strength of the Lord. The eyes of the Lord go to and fro over the whole earth to do what? To show Himself strong for who? For those whose hearts are loyal to Him. Now, Treva and Robin could have said, well, we're going to believe the report of the doctor. But they said, no, we're going to believe the report of the Lord. We're going to saturate ourselves with the Word of God and stand on it and believe it and see the miracle. Now, for you right now, put aside your symptoms. Put aside whatever doctor's report. If you have doubts, start doubting your doubts. And let's just believe God for just a moment, just today, right now, believe Him. And believe this wonderful promise. These are the words of Jesus. When two or more agree touching anything, it shall be done for them by my Father in heaven. So let's put aside everything else and just say, okay, that verse is for me. Now, Terry and I will agree. You agree. And let's come into agreement over your healing right now. And because the Bible says touching, in an act of faith, I want you to lay your hand on that area of the body that needs healing. If it's throughout your body, lay a hand on top of your head. If there are people with you right now, come ask them, will you come over and just lay hands on me? And let's just agree. And let's create that two or more. And let's agree touching it. And let's see what God will do. Let's pray. Lord, we just lift the needs of the audience to you right now. And we come into agreement with them. And as people are laying hands on that area of the body that needs healing, we come into agreement and we say out loud to it, be healed and be made whole by the blood of Jesus Christ, by the stripes. I am healed now in Jesus' name. Sickness, I rebuke you. You have no power over me. The cross has broken your power. Leave me now in Jesus' name. Now, Father, as those who have prayed are believing in you now, we're having faith in you and your wonderful word. So stretch forth your hand now to heal, to set free, to remove all pain now. In Jesus' name. There's a woman, you're laying your hands on your upper stomach. You've got problems with your gallbladder. There was searing pain before you prayed. Now it's completely gone. God's healed you. He's touched you now in Jesus' name. Someone else with a recurring right hip problem, and God is just taking away any spurs, any kind of growth in there now in Jesus' name. You're able to walk freely. He's even able to restore the bone and give you strength in that joint now in Jesus' name. Terry?
There's someone, you have had a really terrible bout with bronchitis and bordering on pneumonia. Every time you take some kind of medication for it, you almost get rid of it and it comes back. And there's a very strange, thick kind of both itchy and painful feeling at the back of your throat. God is healing you and setting you free from that right now, restoring your immune system to its healthy, whole state. You're going to be free from that.
There's someone with liver problems, and it's caused an enlargement, and God is healing that now. He's taken away all the infection. He's able to even restore the tissue to what He originally intended. Just receive it now. In Jesus' name.
Someone else with a pancreatic condition, God is healing that for you right now, and you're not going to suffer from it anymore. Mm-hmm. Someone else, you are waiting for a doctor's call because of a mammogram that you've had. You're fine. You're fine. God's healed you.
And there's someone saying, please say acid reflux. You've got problems with the closing of the flap from your esophagus to your stomach, and God's able to restore that and close that and take away the pain and damage now. In Jesus' name, mm-hmm. Amen.
Amen
and amen. If you've been touched by God, we want to share in your good report. So give us a call. Number's toll free, 888-777-1999. And just a reminder, we're here for you. It's our honor, it's our privilege to pray for you. All you have to do is write down the number, and anytime you need someone to agree with you in prayer, to stand with you in prayer, give us a call. Number's toll free, 888-777-1999. That's all the time we have for today's program. We'll leave you this wonderful word from Hebrews 13, verse 8. Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Understand, He's the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end. By Him, all things were made, and all things will flow to Him at the end. God bless you.